We do have a challenge, which is that if we ignore the climate impacts our emissions are making, then it just gets worse and worse over time.
Bill Gates has spent a lifetime chasing what he calls wild ideas. He famously co-founded Microsoft in 1975, kickstarting the personal computing revolution and an era of innovation that continues to shape our world. However, if you ask him about his achievements, you're more likely to hear stories from the second act of his life, his philanthropic efforts fighting poverty, disease, and inequity. Recently, Bill has been busy with his latest wild ideas, tackling the dual challenges of global health and climate change. As Morgan Stanley's chief equity strategist in India, I've been closely following these issues, which are transforming virtually every sector. I recently had the opportunity to sit down with Bill during a closed-door panel discussion in India and in a one-on-one conversation following the event. We talked about everything from the transition to clean energy to digitalization's role in creating worldwide access to financial services, healthcare, and education. Thank you. Good to have you, Bill. And let me get straight to the subject, energy transition and digitalization. These are two subjects that you're really passionate about. Why? And why now?
Well, digitization can help us in our health system to track patients and do a better job for them. It can help us in our education system, creating things like a tutor that helps a kid catch up and keeps the subject engaging. So digitization is all upside. With the energy systems, many observers, think we're being naive about how much we have to change so quickly. And it's fair to say it's unprecedented. Energy systems historically change fairly slowly. And so we will have to surprise the historical observers by moving at an incredible speed to come up with clean approaches.
Bill is coming to India after a gap of over 3 years. And what I would want to know from him is that if there's anything that has struck him in this three-odd year period that he has seen in India.
Lots gone on. It's great to be back. The pace of digital innovation during this time has been pretty fantastic. In fact, during the pandemic, a lot of the payments that were made, you simply couldn't have achieved when things were shut down. So it was a great validation of the 15 years that we've spent investing in a variety of countries, but India's definitely gotten out in the lead.
On digitalization, Bill, you've mentioned that it is the tool to alleviate poverty. Can you expand on that? Can you explain how does that actually happen?
Well, certainly we've seen here in India that access to bank accounts used to be very much based on your level of income, and that, the difficulty of getting to the bank and the fees for small transactions meant that the normal banking system just wasn't designed to work for everyone. Now, with the cell phone availability having gone up so much and making sure these financial things are available even to feature phones, the idea that everybody can have a savings account, it's not a crazy thing. And, that's something that for the poorest all over the world, I think is going to be quite valuable.
It seems like the world is prepared now for a major change and it's ripe for innovation. What are those specific areas you think where we need funding for innovation in healthcare?
The very rich countries, a lot of the disease burden is cancer, heart disease, depression, Alzheimer's, diabetes. And we have to make big advances in those because the rise in healthcare costs is a challenge for governments everywhere. In the countries at an early stage of development, you still have substantial burden from infectious disease. And that varies a lot country to country, but HIV, malaria, TB, because the rich countries have so little, there's no market for doing those things. The market system works for most things extremely well. But when you have diseases that are largely confined to countries without the big R&D budgets, then the market system fails in that case.
Let me take the question on breakthroughs. So you started that in 2015 to fund some wild ideas in clean energy. Can you give us some example of some of those wild ideas that are coming through?
Well, in 2015, sadly, the focus was really on just the near-term emissions reductions. And because the goal is zero, you don't get a choice. You don't get just to do the easy ones like renewable generation or passenger cars. You have to do the hard ones like planes and meat and cement and steel. We've got to drive innovation, whether it's in government labs, startups, or the big companies. What was most stunning to me was that if you looked up until the year 2015, no government had increased its energy R&D budget. And so the very mechanism that would give you new approaches to make energy, we weren't investing in it. And if you looked at, say, venture companies investing in green technologies, the mismatch between these climate technologies that are very capital intensive, take a long time, have to be scaled up, and the infrastructure that was built largely for digital innovation. It was clear the venture ecosystem was turning away from green tech, and it really wasn't well designed for green tech. So in 2015, I committed on behalf of the private sector to create breakthrough energy to fund startup companies, and the governments there committed to increase their energy R&D budgets. In those 8 years now, we have a lot of great technologies. My metric for those technologies is it more expensive to do it with no emissions than the traditional way of doing it? That's what I call the green premium. Unfortunately, the scale of it is such that, say, if a country like India says to the rich countries, hey, you should subsidize this green premium, that's hundreds of billions. It won't happen. Or if other countries say to India, hey, you should bear this higher price because it's clean, India's appropriately would say, why should we slow down our development of basic shelter just because you rich guys emitted all this carbon? The only way to square the circle is to bring that cost down. And if you get it to near zero, then it's very easy to say, okay, this is the new way to make cement or steel that will let you go full speed ahead in your development, but still meet these ambitious climate goals.
Bill, how does Breakthrough work with Gates Foundation? Can you expand on that relationship?
All of my climate mitigation work is done through Breakthrough Energy. So even though my goal is not to make money there, we only invest in climate companies, and we only invest in companies that have a chance of making huge reductions in over 0.5% of all the emissions. The climate adaptation work, which is the term for helping countries not suffer the damage, that is all Gates Foundation, because that is all philanthropic, whereas Breakthrough Energy is about a catalytic effort that engages private sector forces at a mind-blowing scale. Since 2015, a lot of innovation has come forward. A lot more research, a lot of smart young people deciding to go into climate technologies. Even just Breakthrough Energy alone, my climate work is invested in over 110 companies that cover all the different areas of emissions, agriculture, transport, electricity, and industry, and buildings. So I'm feeling hopeful that if we can scale those things up and get the prices so you're not paying a premium for being green, you know, that we have a chance of getting very close to the ambitious climate goals.
Are there any interesting innovations that are emerging from those 110 ventures which you have funded?
I could go on and on. You know, there's two things that stand out that would be great for humanity. One is if nuclear fission was cheap and safe and we had a good waste solution. And the other is if nuclear fusion was cheap and safe. Those are two sources of energy that we've always had a lot of hope for. So a possibility is that nuclear can play a significant role. Now, that's not to say we shouldn't go full speed ahead with wind and solar. The faster we can do wind and solar everywhere in the world and build the grids to connect all this together, that's clearly going to be part of the solution. You know, between now and 2030, across all areas of mission, we'd like to have big projects that are showing that the green approach is not super expensive. So it's a daunting challenge, but that's, you know, that's what has to be done.
How will the world look like at net zero?
Well, it'll be a lot cleaner because these electric technologies, they're locally clean. as well as very quiet. You know, you'll still have cars and buses. You'll still have steel and cement. You know, I'm not a person who believes that we'll stop, you know, consuming or that lifestyles will change in some dramatic way. I don't think it'll slow down economic development. I mean, that's really the goal. You know, and this is all fairly soon. I mean, hopefully I'll be around to see it. You know, it's all within like, you know, 30 years that we're supposed to have done this.
Well, with that, thank you so much, Bill, for sharing your insights. Thank you so much for your time.
Great to
see you.
Pleasure
speaking to you.